were growing cells during 3 months, changing the division rate, so changing the status of the chemostat. And this is more or less what is happening here. So the numbers here are the values of the division rate. Right? They started at this division rate, 0.45, and then this is in the stationary state, this is more or less the number of cells they get. So they change the dilution rate, they decrease the dilution rate, and more or less they find this number here. They define this, I mean, those are poor experimenters, they define that this is stationary. And then they change again the dilution rate and find this one, and then they went back to 0.4, and look that this number here is different from here. More important, they moved to 0.45, which was the original one, and clearly a very different stationary state in the system. Now, if you put all these points in the same phase diagram we made before, X and D, that's what you find. So, you start here, then you move here, then this point here is the last one, is the only one that is repeated in both ways, and then when you start to increase again, you get in a different, completely different point. More important than that, this is work in progress, so we are still processing the data. And this was done again within this project in Glasgow. If you look here, the concentration of lactate, the toxic product, and the concentration of lactate here is completely different. Actually, here you have much more lactate than here. Therefore, the picture is again consistent. Then we move a step forward and say, all right, let's try to see what's happening if, instead of having all the cells that are perfect and that they are maximizing the growth rate, we have heterogeneity in the system. And this map means maximum entropy principle. So we are trying to use the maximum entropy principle to study the system, assuming that not all the cells are very rapidly maximizing their growth rate, right? So the picture is the same, but we are not to make any, within the cell, we are not to make any more the assumption that the cells maximize growth rate, so the problem is completely different. It's very hard because now what you have to do is to sample over all the space of solution, because what you say is that we have a lot of cells, all of them can, each one of them can be in a very different metabolic state, and I have to average all my set of equations within all this bunch of stuff, right? So again, for the chemostat, we get the same system, the same equation, sorry. And then we are going to make a subtle assumption that we say, all right, if we are already in this stationary state, we can say that dx dt is zero, and therefore that mu is equal to sigma minus d, right? What is interesting here is that, that's the way we are going to use, is that the only parameter that experimentalists can tune is actually d. That's the dilution rate, that's something they can change. While mu is something that is what appears, it's the growth rate of the system that will depend on the equation. And then what we say is, all right, we use the maximum entropy principle, and we say, if we know that D is fixed, you can imagine that the mean energy of the system is fixed, and mu can take different values, how is the system distributed? And what you get, of course, using maximum entropy principle is that you get an exponential with a Lagrange multiplier. Right? What you say is that the polytope can be described by a set of functions that follow this kind of law. Right? That's essentially...
D should be inside the parameters there, somehow in the temperature. So.
Well, this for a given D. Uh-huh. This for a given D, it's there.
The temperature depends on D.
No, the temperature, no. The temperature, the temperature not. Now the question is, how do you interpret the temperature? So what's the relation? So there are a few interpretations there, like the, but well, one of them is to say, I don't want to interpret it, this is just a parameter and that's it. Yeah, there's nothing to say. But you, what Andrea De Martino in a different paper in which he used also a maximum entropy principle, interpret this as a sort of a connection with the growth rate of the system or the time scale of the division, and we in this paper we connected it with the rate at which the mutation happens in the culture, more or less. But let's say, in the worst case, if you don't want an interpretation, you can say this is just a Lagrange parameter that is fixing the condition of your experiments.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Yes. A question. So. X also should be a stochastic variable, right?
Well, X
So to some extent, if you add noise there,
yes,
because it's a linear equation and a stochastic term, the distribution of x should be also
an exponential.
Should be a Gaussian.
Yes.
If sigma is white noise, if the noise that you
put, yes.
Shouldn't that be included there? Mm.
If you want, let's say, you can't, but...
Because by its very stochastic nature, the number should change in time, the number of cells should change in time.
This is true, but let's say, what we are assuming is that this is a macroscopic variable, if you want, so therefore it's constant, and what is actually changing is the reaction inside the cell. So in the sense that you can take this as constant, in any way, it's constant plus fluctuation. We disregard the fluctuation if you want. And then what we say is, all right, this is fixed, but what is happening is something happening in the interior of the cell. So the metabolism for each cell is different for reason that we don't control. That's what we say. And all right, let's go back. And what you get is something like this. At the end, so Alejandro, you were right. For each D, you have a beta. So given D, which is this one here, what you have to solve now is this set of equations. This is, if you want, the energy of the system. So if you remind the way in which you derive the canonical ensemble in statistical physics, D is the control parameter, the energy. This is the microscopic energy, the definition. This is the way in which P is solved. This is our exponential before, so this is Boltzmann, essentially. And what we say is also that in stationary state, you get this concentration here of the metabolites that follow this law. Right? This is, instead of having Ci minus X, U, this is the average U, and here you have the X. This psi here is X divided by D. So this is the same equation we had before. Now we are assuming that instead of having one cell that is doing all of them the same, we have many cells, so we have to average something. And the way to average this is to say that we have the average fluxes of the system. Well, that's more or less the idea. And then you have to solve this self-consistently. And you can imagine, and there are two ways to interpret this result. One way is to say, all right, what will be the actual dynamics of the system if I do this instead of assuming that everybody would be maximizing the growth rate. That's one picture, in the sense you are solving what we call the direct problem. Right? And there is a second, so therefore you essentially fix beta. You say, this is my beta, which is connected to something, for example, the mutation rate, that's also you can prove, at least for simple models, and try to understand the direct problem. That's something, the equivalent to what we did 5 minutes ago. But you have also a second problem, which is what we call the inverse problem, in which I give you the D, the dilution rate, and that's the only thing I gave to you, and I give you also the stoichiometric matrix. And then I ask you, try to predict which are the fluxes inside the system. Because this P here determines how the fluxes distribute within the system, right? So for the first case we did, that's the most interesting plot, in my opinion, is this one here. This is the way in which, depending on beta, you have different concentration of nutrients in the of metabolites in the system, right? If you look for the phase diagram, you find a phase diagram that is very similar to the one I found before. So you find the two branches and the two branches changes. I'm not going to discuss this here because we don't have too much time. But what is interesting here is that if at first you thought that changing beta, you will lose only exploring a different way the space of solution and get, I would say, kind of monotonic behavior for everything that is happening. What you find here is that this is not true. So for example, you see that there are important jumps in many metabolites, and also that the curve in many cases crosses each other. So it is not always true that red is below everything else and that black is above everything else, for example. So changing beta, you find that what's happening inside the system is actually changing, right? And that's something to discuss for the direct problem. And then we ask ourselves, let's try to look at the inverse problem, which is infinite, more or less, was devoted to that. Now we have some data. I will show you only result for E. coli that we obtained from the experimental, from the literature. And we are comparing also with mammalian cells, and the results more or less are as good as this one I am going to show you. And this is the plot. So, in the, these are three kind of the three metabolites. Sorry. I think this is acetate, this is fumarate, I think, and this is glutamine, right? And these are the prediction if you are, right, in the X, you have the value of the concentration of these metabolites obtained by the experiment. So, we found in the experiment in the literature. They have D and they have everything, so we use this D, we made this, this extraction of what is going on. And in the y-axis, you have the prediction in this column here, if you assume that all the cells are the same. And in the second branch here, the prediction, if you assume that we are in a maximum entropy scenario in which you have some heterogeneity and you have a parameter to fix the growth rate of the system, right? And I think the difference is quite clear, and that the fact that the results are much better if you assume this experimental this scenario in which you have entropy, in which you have heterogeneity, that if you assume this scenario here, right? These are still preliminary results. Now we are working with much more data that came from a colleague in England. I wanted to mention before that to compute this here, and again, that was the kind of collaboration Infernet allowed us. This is a very hard integral because we're computing a very hard space, but this is something that Andrea Bagnani and Alfredo Braunstein learned to do, I mean, propose how to do using something called now expectation propagation, and that's something that we got also because of this collaboration. So now I go to the second part of my talk. Yes.
Before you, so if I understand correctly, you also have another prediction in this model that basically, if you take many populations, the fluctuations across them should be related to the dilution. Many populations are grown with the same dilution rate. The fluctuations across them, I'm not sure of what, but basically in some, I don't know, intracellular property, probably, I don't know, they should be related to the dilution rate. So the dilution rate controls also the fluctuations.
Well, it controls in this way.
That's the mean value, right?
But that's the only thing we try.
Yeah, but you can.
You're telling me what I did or what you.
What you, there's an extra thing.
That I did.
No. If I understand correctly, what you do on top of this, there is something else that you could look at.
Ah.
Is that also the fluctuations should be related to the dilution rate? If you have many different populations growing with the same dilution, they will not be identical. There will be some variability.
All right.
And the variability is controlled by the.
But I think that that's controlled by beta.
But beta is the dilution rate. It's tied to the dilution rate.
That, no, that's not my interpretation. That was your interpretation, if you want. Yes. No, my interpretation in this model here is that beta is connected with the mutation in the metabolite, in the metabolism. So if you imagine a cell that's we did. So imagine, if you go, we play with the simple model, I mean forget about it, the small model.
Okay, yeah.
You take the small model and you say, all right, now imagine that you have all the cells are the same, but some of them are mutating, right?
Okay,
and you fix, and then what you find is that depending on the mutation, you will get different betas when you do the inverse problem. That's what you need. That's why, so the interpretation is, it depends on the actual setup.
So in this new part that you are studying, the heterogeneity inside the culture, is it still valid the two-states model that you...
Yes.
So in principle, you should have in the same culture some cells that are working. I mean, you have the same concentration of lactate, so the situation is the same. So in the point where you have both phases alive, you can have actually in the same culture cells living in this state and cells living in that state.
Yes, in principle, yes.
And in principle, if one of them has a faster growing rate than the other, should over.
No, but it doesn't matter because you have the D that is controlling. This is a stationary. This is a chemostat. So you don't have a culture in which only the one that.
So you say that when you have stability, both growing rates are the same in both.
No, the growing rate are different. You're right. No, what I'm saying, in fact, I am not.
Yeah, it's the Cuban flag.
So, don't make me fake jokes.